Hallelujah, louder than the elements. could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
Oh, Our high Yes, Lord, we exalt you, not just because of what you've done, but because of who you are.
We give you praise and honor and glory, all to you.
The church is so well represented tonight. God bless you for coming. We have a very special speaker.
What?
I can't see him, but he's somewhere. There is at the back. We have with us our regional superintendent, Pastor Paul Hudson. He's going to come now. Woo! And he's going, let's give him a hand. To welcome him, I just said he's just so awesome and we love him.
Thank you.
And I know we're going to be blessed tonight. Bless you, man.
Hi.
Hi.
I know it makes me okay that you came. Hi!
Hi!
What a great place! Oh, what's in it? Whoa, what's in it? You're right as well. Well, it's going to be a good one. I've been looking forward to this evening so much. I love these guys, Mark and Alistair and Johnny. I just love what the fact that actually... do you love the guys?
Yes.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah, okay. It's a work in progress, I know. But I love what they're doing. All three of them are very, very different, have different styles and different giftings, and yet are leading these three great churches that I do love. I love this whole area. I love where New Beginnings is because it's my home area where I did all my schooling and where I became intelligent. And then, of course, the church in the centre of Halifax, I love that. It's where I got baptised and I forgot to take a breath, and it was a great experience. And so just coming back here was great, and I've just been sitting in the back, not because I'm a backslider. I know I'm suggesting those who are sitting in the back are backsliding, but I just wanted to sit with my friends and Duncan and Beverly, and they were on the team. You heard of them? They were pastoring this church years ago, but before that they were on team with me in Dewsbury, and I just love those guys, and they're planting church in Hebden, and so it's great, lovely. And this is really good, isn't it? This, not the stage, I mean the people who were here before. You led our worship really, really well, and really sense the presence of God, so let's just honour them, shall we? Holy Spirit, thank you that you are here in this place this evening, and thank you that you know every person that's come. Thank you that you're here. And you know those who are just about wanting to give up, but they're not going to give up tonight. And will you do something surprising in the lives of people that have come thinking this is just a church service? In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so get your Bible out, or on iPad, or wherever it is, some device, whatever, mobile phone, whatever it is. I've got a paper copy, and I know, they're very rare. Acts chapter 5, we're going to read a passage there. In Acts 5, I want you to take your imagination with me. Acts chapter 5, and in verse 17, we're going to read that. Those who haven't got the Bible with them, you obviously know this story off by heart. I won't ask you to come forward and recite it off by heart. I'll read it. Here we go, really quickly. Then the high priest and all his associates, who were members of the party of the Sadducees, were filled with jealousy, and they arrested the apostles and put them in the public jail. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the doors of the jail and brought them out. Go stand in the temple court, he said, and tell the people the full message of this new life. At daybreak, they entered the temple courts, as they had been told, and began to teach the people. And when the high priest and his associates arrived, they called together the Sanhedrin, the full assembly of the elders of Israel, and sent to the jail for the apostles. But on arriving at the jail, the officers did not find them there. So they went back and reported, "We found the jail securely locked, with the guards standing at the doors. But when we opened them, we found no one inside." I just think that's really funny. Anyway, it's just probably me. On hearing this report, the captain of the temple guard and the chief priests were puzzled, wondering what would have come of this. And someone came and said, "Look, the man you put in jail are standing in the temple courts teaching the people." And at that, the captain went with his officers and brought the apostles. They didn't want to use force because they feared that the people would stone them. Having brought the apostles, they made them appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name," he said. "Yet you have filled Jerusalem
with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood. Peter and the other apostles replied, we must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised Jesus from the dead, whom you have killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Saviour, that he might give repentance and forgiveness of sins to Israel. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. When they heard this, they were furious and wanted to put them to death. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, who was honored by all the people, stood up in the Sanhedrin and ordered that the men be put outside for a little while. Then he addressed them, men of Israel, consider carefully what you intend to do to these men. Some time ago, Theudas appeared, claiming to be somebody, and about 400 men rallied to him, and he was killed, and all his followers were dispersed, and it all came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean appeared in the days of the census and led a band of people in revolt. He too was killed, and all his followers were scattered. Therefore, in the present case, I advise you, leave these men alone and let them go. For if their purpose or activity is of human origin, it will fail. But if it is from God, you will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourselves fighting against God. His speech persuaded them. They called the apostles in and had them flogged. Then they ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. And the apostles left the Sanhedrin rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. Day after day in the temple courts and from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Christ. Amen. I've got three words in a sentence, three word sentence, and that's my message for you. And I believe this is what God wants you to know. And I don't know your situation, and I don't know what you're facing, and I don't know what the challenges of your life is, and I don't know what's coming against you. What I do know is that you've got a father of lies who will never tell you the truth. He will masquerade himself as an angel of light. He'll come at you with temptations and trials, and he'll use people, because our fight is not against flesh and blood, but it's what's behind it. He'll use every circumstance and situation of your life. He'll turn things around, and he'll just continually badger at you. And I'm telling you a message here from heaven this evening for you is this. You can continue. You can continue. So in 1995, I made a phone call to an acquaintance that I didn't know very well. And he'd just been put on the scrap heap of life. He was a minister, discarded by his colleagues, and he was put on the scrap heap of life. I didn't realize what that phone call would lead to, that this man would become the closest man in my life for the next 2 decades. But I phoned that man and I said, you don't really know me very well, but I feel called of God to call you and say, I want to help you. This man was 20 years my senior, and I was obviously very, very, very young. Very, very, very young, obviously. I called him and said, look, I've just got a message for you. And regardless of what man has done, you can continue. And that man became a really close friend of mine, my spiritual mentor. In 2001, I was taken to an employment tribunal because I sacked a member of staff. Because of gross misconduct. And this man was, before his conversion, was a terrorist in Ireland, and was one of the terrorist groups in Ireland. And he got converted and was part of our staff. And we let him go and took me to an employment tribunal. And for 18 months, it was the darkest time of my life at that time. And he also had connections, even with the Daily Mail, and they'd sent a reporter to try and get a story. And they wanted an out-of-court settlement of £30,000. And at the time, some person in Elim had forgotten to pay the policy for 3 months, the insurance policy for our churches, and so we were out of insurance. Just my luck, we don't believe in it, but we do when we're in bad luck.
So we were really up the creek without a paddle. And so me and my wife decided that we would seek a personal loan because we wanted to take the church to it. And I began to scan the papers because I was coming out of the ministry as soon as this came through. And for 18 months we went through a court case and we came through it. And even though the Yorkshire Post enjoyed the story, we came through it because there was no case to answer and God brought us through. And I learned in 2001 that I could continue even though my life had crashed down. In 2012, I was in a hospice car park of Wakefield Hospice. And I journeyed with a man for 2 years, which the church believed that this man would be healed of cancer, and he died. And on that night, I was there when he went to be with Jesus. And over those 2 years, I'd grown to love this man more than ever I had done as his pastor. And I came out of the hospice, and I was so enraged that God had not answered any the prayers of my heart. And I stood outside my car, and I said, "God, that's it. That's it. You know, you've not answered this prayer, and I'm crushed, and I can't stand before people anymore. And so I'm finished." And God, in His way, God has a certain way of talking to me, and it kind of like goes like this: "Stop being stupid, and you can continue." 2017, I'm at the graveside of this man that I called in 1995, my spiritual mentor for 22 years. There wasn't a day of our life that we had not either phoned each other or texted each other. He led me through so many things. And in 2017, he died whilst he was preaching in Ireland. He just dropped down dead. And I'm at the graveside, and I'm asking myself, how do you keep going? And over the last 2.5 years, boy, have I needed him. But I found that even when you think you can't keep going, you can continue.
Yeah.
This is what God does. And I'm here this evening, and I don't know, as I said, I don't know your situation. But I believe the Holy Spirit wants to say to you, it's too early to give up. So whether you've had malicious lies, whether you've had slander, whether you've had people misunderstand you, whether circumstances may threaten you, situations are trying to get at you, but there's a father of lies that wants to bring you down and finish you off. And you may have had to run away, you may have had to take a sidestep, you may have had to just take some time out. But I'm here this evening just to say, listen, when one door comes crashing on you, it seems that God makes a way and God brings you through. Now, how does that happen? And what can we learn from this story this evening? What can I share with you? Just three simple things, because we go in threes, don't we, apparently. So firstly, I just want to ask a question, where were they? And in verse 18, the apostles, they were in a jail. It doesn't matter what has gripped you or what has contained you. Whatever has put you in a box and whatever has entrapped you, that's not the last voice. It doesn't have the final say over your life. The apostles who are the sent ones, the ones who are going to go all over the world, they're going nowhere, they're treading water, they're in the jail. And you might be thinking that you're going through a season and you're just wondering, if I only had a little bit of results, that'd be quite nice, God. Do you know where I am? Do you know what's going on? You know, just give me a little nod, you know, if you think I'm alive, you know, because actually everybody around me just seems to be having one miracle after a miracle, but actually squat all going on in my life. And you know, the enemy of your life is not interested in trying to crush you. He's not out to crush you. He knows he can't crush you, but he can try and contain you. He can come into your mind and into your thinking and through a situation, can box you in, so that actually you think, I can't move, I can't breathe. You know, this situation is just closing in on me. And the circumstance of your life can be like that. But don't panic, God hasn't finished with you yet. They were held, they were contained, but it wasn't going to have the final thing. See, in verse 22, it's just so lovely that on arriving at the jail, they weren't there. I love that. The fact that actually, you know, the enemy thought, we know where they are now. We've got them here. And the devil of your life, the father of your of lies, the one who's the enemy of your soul, he'll never promise anything to you that's true. Just wants to put you somewhere where you can't move. And so the Sanhedrin sent messengers to go and get them. Well, they're not here. They're not where they should be. My friends, it's been, you know, you need to understand this evening that you are not where you should be. Because the enemy of your life had you over here. And well, that's it, I've contained them. But look at you now, you're worshipping God. Yeah. You're released. Right. But so I'm combating what may be going on in your mind, that the enemy of your life wants to say, that's where you are, that's where you belong. No. You're here this evening. You're worshipping a living God. You were once shackled. You were once imprisoned. You were once contained, but no more. Yeah. You're living for Jesus. Amen? Well, yeah. You are free. You're free indeed. And I just need to remind you that actually the truth set you free, and you are free indeed. And you don't need to go back to being imprisoned to like you once were. We were in the jail, but we're not in the jail now. Yeah, we did some jail time, but we're not in the jail now. Yeah, he had his way in our life, but he's not having his way in our life right now. And even if you are trapped, and even if you are in a circumstance, the Apostle Paul helps us to understand that actually, though I am in prison, that's not where I am, you see, because I live in the heavenly realms. I'm seated with Christ. Well, no, what do you mean you're seated with Christ? What do you mean heavenly realms? Why are you so positive? You are in a jail, physically. You are trapped. You physically, you are there. You are not set free, Paul. And you're saying you're in a heavenly realms. Yeah, that's where I am. And I think I'll stay here. And I think I'll win the prison for Jesus. See, there are times when God will release you out of the prison. Times when God will keep you in that containment. Because actually, he's sovereign, bigger than what the devil is. And he'll use your circumstance. And he'll use your situation. So, they were not there. That's where they were, but they were not there now. And they are out in the town square, and they're doing what they were put in there for. You know, isn't it interesting? You know, you and I would be thinking, okay, we're thanking Jesus for getting us out of here. Let's not go and do the same thing that put us in there. You know, that's crazy, yeah? Unless you're passionate. Yes. You see, if you're just church people, if you're just religious people, and you know you can be as religious and shabba dabba doo da and put your hands up in the air, be as religious as whatever. Yeah?
Yes.
Honestly. So, but if you are like that, you're going to go, from now on, we're going to go an easy road. We're not certainly not going to go and put ourselves in danger again. Friends, you and I, we need to live in the danger zone.
Yeah.
And that's the difference. Around the world, people, you know, Christians like you and me, go and live in the danger zone because that's where people need Christ. You know, whereas maybe we want to stay at home and just watch Songs of Praise. No, I'm glad you're saying no. There's nothing wrong with Songs of Praise. How dare you touch that? You really like it, and you may have recorded it for later on, praise God. There was nothing wrong with the lock. Security was impenetrable, and the guards were not asleep. The guards were not off duty. How does this happen? I don't know how it happened. Luke just writes that an angel came and opened it. I mean, how does that happen? I mean, the gate, the guards are awake. So how does an angel come and open a prison door and they come out? But the guards have not fallen asleep, and the guards have not gone off duty, and the guards don't see the angel. Neither do the guards see Peter and the apostles saying, "Cheers, thanks, we're out of here." You know, I mean, how does this happen? There's a whole massive thing about this story that I don't get, and I don't understand it. And there's a lot of things about your life that even if you told me, I wouldn't get it. But what you say is this: I can't fully explain everything, but God made a way where there was no way. God seemed to take my circumstance and pull me out of it and brought me into a place of freedom. So that people say to you, how can you be so joyful? How can you be so at peace when the circumstances of your life are so bad? I don't know. But he did something. He did something for me. I was blind, but now I see. I don't get it.
I was once really, really, you know, ugly and sinful. Now I'm just ugly and not sinful. You know, I don't.
Thank you.
I did that just to get some praise. Appreciate it. So, we are not there anymore. Second question. Who was with them? I love this little thing that Peter says. When he says, he does a sermon all about Jesus, and we're going to look at that in my third point, but he says this: we are witnesses of Jesus who was crucified, you did it, who was raised to life, and who was ascended and exalted. We saw that. If you put us in a court of law, we'll stand up and we'll say, we saw it. But he says something else. He says something else. Which I'm so thank God he said something else. Because if it was just, we are witnesses of these things, full stop, what good that would that be for you and me today, 2,000 years ago, that you and I are following some religion, some experience of a man and some other men 2,000 years ago who witnessed Jesus on earth? What good would that be? I mean, that's just like every other religion in the world. Peter doesn't say that. He doesn't put a full stop there. He says this: we are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit. He saw it too. He was involved in it too. Now why is that so amazingly important? Peter has understood that there's a partnership that we are involved in, which the Apostle Paul would then also pick up throughout the whole of the New Testament, and would talk about a partnership between you and the Holy Spirit. That your life here on earth is not just about you, it's about you and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And actually, he's seen and been involved in far more things than you have, praise God. Amen?
Amen.
The Holy Spirit has not passed away, Peter has. The Holy Spirit is alive today, right across generations, right across the world. The same Holy Spirit who Peter says is a witness is today in our lives witnessing to us in every doubt, in every fear, in every situation, in every circumstance of our life. And where is the Holy Spirit? He's been given to those who will obey. He's been given to those who will walk with Jesus. And so, when, you know, why do you think it is? Why do you think it is, you know, you go to bed at night, you're thinking, no, that's it, I'm fed up with Christianity, I'm going to pack it in tomorrow morning, right? I mean, maybe you don't do that. I mean, but I've heard somewhere, somebody might think that. I'm looking at you tonight thinking, no, that won't apply because you're very holy. I can see you're very holy. But some people do go to bed at night time, they want to pack it in, I don't do this anymore. And in the morning, they get up in the morning and go, I'll give it another go. Where do you think that comes from? Do you think that comes from your own human willpower? Well, look at me, I can really keep going. Not at all. There's nothing in you, in your natural human being, would follow this Christian life. There's nothing. But something within you is saying, what are you doing giving up? Do you think that's how we do life? Just giving up? You know, who do you think got Jesus out of the grave? If I can get Jesus out of the grave, I can get you out of bed in the morning and get you going again. Yeah? You know, maybe tonight you're thinking, oh, my life is just nothing. Just nothing happening. I can't see anything. Just darkness, you know? You know, just a void. Maybe, you know, all the miracles that you're looking for are just not happening. And you're thinking, that's it. It's just doom. It's just like a void. You know, and where do you think the thought comes from that actually God can still, even when it doesn't look like? It's not coming from your brain. You're not that intelligent. You know, you're not that important either. You know, but there's something inside you It's the Holy Spirit who said, excuse me, can I just speak into this, you know, while you rock yourself into a depression? Can I just speak into this for a moment? Who do you think was hovering over the surface of the deep when there was nothing, you know, just absolute squat all in this universe? Who do you think was just hovering over all of that darkness and gloom and void and a chasm of nothing? Who do you think was there? Right? It is me. So don't you tell me what can not happen and what can happen. When I'm in your life, I can do anything at any moment, at any time in your life, because I've witnessed loads of stuff before you were even born. Yeah. Is anybody with me?
Yeah.
Why do you think, you know, you're still in relationship with that strange person called your husband, you know, and you look over it in the morning and you go, what was I thinking? what was it? I must have been drunk when I said, what was I doing? I hate him. I really hate him. What is it that I mean, look, even here tonight, I mean, look at you right now. I mean, like, you're really all odd. You know, you're all different. I mean, odd, not even. I mean, you're all different, you know? I mean, look at the person next to you. How odd are they? Yeah? I mean, just really a little bit strange, yeah? You know? But it's church, isn't it? Unless you've got a church, unless you're in church and you're all the same, which is boring, but how does it work? How does church work? How do we do this stuff when everybody's just a little bit different? Yeah? How do we get peace? How do we put that together? Listen, there's not one leadership team on planet Earth that can put that together. But it's the Holy Spirit who has the power for unity and the bond of peace that says, you know, I can bring the opposites together. I can keep them together. If I'm holding this world, this spinning world, if I'm holding the whole universe, if the power of God is able not only to create something that's just unimaginable and unsustainable, but is able to do that and keep it spinning and keep it going, then don't you think that he can keep a couple of people together?
Yeah.
We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit. He's witnessed these things. When the disciples were wondering what to do, Jesus has gone, and they're just on their own, and okay, we've got to take this world for Jesus with a message, and I don't know who's going first, I don't want to go first, and the bag's not me, and they're just like behind closed doors, and they're just praying, oh God, you know, do something, whatever, and then, you know, then he breaks in powerfully upon this broken, bruised, defeated, failed bunch of people, and the power of God comes upon them and everything is changed. And from that moment of the move of the Spirit upon their lives, there's a possibility break out, opportunities break out. You know, young girl Mary goes, Gabriel, you know, the thing is, right, with this great idea of yours, you've overlooked the fact that actually I'm a virgin. Do you know what a virgin is? You know, Gabriel, like, what are you saying to me? You know, I just don't get it at all. And Gabriel says, listen, I'm ready for this one. They told me before I came. Listen, here's the message. The Holy Spirit will overshadow you. And when the Holy Spirit overshadows you, what you think is impossible is suddenly possible.
Amen.
See, the Holy Spirit has not been given to you so that you can have one or two little gifts. Put your hands up in the air and move your toes. And oh, we're having a great time. The Holy Spirit's been given to you for life. To break out, break in, and to see God's purpose fulfilled in your life. Do you know him? The prayer is, hover over me, Holy Spirit. Overshadow my life. Come down on me. Cloak me in you. fill me. Not so that I feel good, but fill me. Because there are times when I need a break out. There are times when I'm facing fear and the enemy attack on my life. And I need you, who's witnessed everything since creation and all the way through. And I need you to tell me and remind me of what is possible and what I can do, that actually I can continue. I can keep going forward. And if I give up now, I'm going to be giving up short of a miracle. Let me say a third thing for you. This is my final thing. Where were they? They were not where the enemy put them. Who was with them? The Holy Spirit. Who were they following? Let me tell you who they were following. They were following the one who shed his blood. Here's the Sanhedrin. We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name, yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood. The Sanhedrin, these very same people, are the ones who sentenced Jesus to the cross. They accused him of blasphemy, a mock trial, and they made sure that that's where he went. They were indeed guilty of the blood of Jesus. However, isn't it wonderful that these enemies of Jesus thought that all of their city was filled with the teaching of this man's blood? Wouldn't it be lovely if Sowerby and Halifax, wouldn't it be lovely if everybody was saying, have you heard about the message about this blood of Jesus? The enemies of Jesus were so concerned that everybody was talking about the blood of Jesus. Wouldn't that be lovely? My friends, that is still our message today. The power, we sang it tonight, the power of the blood of Jesus to transform and change a person's life. May our homes and our towns and our cities in the UK be filled in such a way. More and more people need to know about the sacrificial death of Jesus to change a man and woman's life completely. Now, the enemy of your life does not want you to hear this. It doesn't mind you hearing about church. It doesn't mind you hearing about church and all the programs and all the things that are going on in the life of the church. It's hard. Yes, fine. But talk about the blood of Jesus. You see, because there's not one church program that can transform a person's life except the blood of Jesus. Yeah. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. Your life is built on the saving, cleansing, redeeming, justifying, reconciling, eternal, sanctifying, overcoming, redeeming blood of Jesus. That's what's done for your life. And these early apostles were following the one who shed his blood, and they truly believed in it. And I feel there's a passionate call for the UK to come back to that first time call of following the blood of Jesus. They were following the one who was raised to life. The God of our fathers raised Jesus from the dead, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. Putting Jesus to death was the worst decision they had made. It was despicable that they would put a sinless Saviour on the cross. But what's the worst thing that you have done? Well, we're not going to tell anybody, are we? What's the worst thing you've done? If God can raise Jesus from the grave, then he can right any wrong that you have also done. But of course, there's one other amazing thing, because there's the sovereignty of God attached to this. See, the Sanhedrin thought, and it looked like they were in control, sentencing Jesus to death. He's gone. We've got rid of him. The truth is that they were not in control. The truth is that Jesus was not killed. The truth is that actually Jesus came and laid his life down, and he surrendered his spirit to the will of his Father for the salvation of the world. Jesus paid so that man does not need to pay for sin. Even in the worst enemy situation of your life, it sits in the sovereign plan of God if you belong to Jesus. So what is the worst thing that has ever happened to you? And you may not see it right now, and you may be right in the middle of a real circumstance that's really horrible, and you might not see what, how can anything possibly come from this? And it may take more than 3 days, but there's going to come a resurrection of your situation, a resurrection of your life, and you will look back, and you will indeed say that what looked like the hand of the enemy was actually the finger of God. They were following the one who's raised to life. It consumed, the resurrection consumed their life. That's who they were following. They were following the one who is exalted, but they were all exalted. And I'll move on. They were following the one who is unstoppable. If it's from God, you will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourselves fighting against God. No action of God, no movement of from God, nor his messages or his acts of love towards you can be stopped by man. We have an unstoppable God. They knew it. Their God was like, you know, there's nothing that he can't break through. And if he has decided to bless you, then who can stop him? His name is higher than any other name. He's got a greater authority than anything in the whole of the universe. So it's laughable, it's a joke to think that actually something can stop him from having his way in your life. Man might come and say, I've stopped you. No, don't be stupid. I serve an unstoppable God who says to me, okay, well, I can't go down that path, but I'm going to go down another path. I will not stop. I will not give up. I will not back down. I will not move away. I will not say, well, that's it. I can't do it anymore. I will continue because I'm serving an unstoppable God who's in my life. You may be facing uncertainty today, and you may wonder if you'll ever get through. It's a guarantee.
Amen.
A guarantee. You're going to get through.
Amen.
You'll make it. Let me conclude and say this. So, what am I saying? Jesus sets you free. He's given you the Holy Spirit. You follow the one who is raised and exalted and is unstoppable. So we continue, and right at the end of the passage, it says, day after day, from house to house, they never stop teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Christ. Day after day, they never stopped telling people the good news about Jesus Christ. Never stopped. Didn't grow tired. Didn't lose focus. Didn't become afraid. Didn't say, what we'll do evangelism in June from now on. It's like tonight. We'll go through autumn and winter and we'll just pray, and then we'll explode in June, month of evangelism. No, day after day, day after day,
yeah.
What they were put in prison for, day after day, never stopped. Didn't water down, didn't taper off, didn't say, let's do acts of kindness instead. Let's not tell people. Let's not communicate. Let's just give them a box of chocolates. And they'll know that. They'll know, they can see Jesus in our face. You know, let's annoy society. Let's disrupt our culture. Let's stand up and be bold and to be fearless.
Yeah. Yeah.
And actually, we're going to do this because we believe in this.
Yeah.
And I'm not convinced that all the church in the UK believe what they sing. But I'm wondering tonight if there's anyone who is hearing a refreshing of the Holy Spirit and you're starting to realize, hey, I'm not going to let go. I'm not going to, this is not about me. This is not about me being blessed. It's not about what I gain. This is about the world. And I'm going to keep on telling people about Jesus. I'm not going to be afraid. I'm not going to back down. You can continue. You can keep going. Holy Spirit, you know, who's here this evening, you know what, that they've been facing some real difficult challenges perhaps, and they've been singing tonight and they've been carrying maybe a heaviness in their heart perhaps of
circumstance. Maybe the enemy of their life has just been plaguing them, and maybe they're just wondering if they're ever going to get through. And this message this evening that they can continue because of the fact that you, Holy Spirit, are here this evening, and you're here to fill our lives, you're here to empower us, you're here to remind us of all that God is, that you are unstoppable, that actually we don't follow a religion, we don't follow a man, but we follow the Son of Man who came and died upon a cross, shed his blood, who was raised, who was exalted, who was ascended, and is on high today. And Jesus, you have the same power as you had when you walked the earth, and even more so. And God, I pray that every man and woman in this place this evening, God, I pray that the filling of the Holy Spirit and the power and the presence of God will just soak their life, will just consume and overwhelm them, that no matter what the devil does, no matter what the devil causes them to be afraid, no matter what he's speaking into their ear, no matter what the situation, they'll stand up and they say, hey, I am serving an unstoppable God. Where the devil tries to contain me, that's not going to contain me. What the devil says to me, I'm not going to trust that anymore. I'm going to listen and follow Jesus Christ. Come, Holy Spirit. You are welcome to fill our lives right now. Let's stand to our feet, shall we? Just lift up our hands to Jesus and let us just begin to seek the Lord right now. Come, Holy Spirit. Can my friend, the worship leader, come just help me here? I don't need a full band. Remind me of your name again? Niall. I knew that. Was testing you. Nine, great, thank you. Okay. I've not come just to play at a church service. I hate church services, but I do love meeting God. So what I'm going to do in a moment, I'm going to give a call to people who want to be filled with the power of God's Spirit, and I'm going to give a call to those who may feel trapped and contained, and we're going to sort of break some things off your life, and we're going to see a release and a new way taking place in your life. But if you need just an outpouring and a filling of the Holy Spirit upon your life again, and I want you to just quickly come forward to the front here, just gather around the stage. Want our eyes upon Jesus as we worship Him in this song. I don't want you to delay, because I'm not gonna delay it. But I just want you to come quickly. So just come right now. Just as we begin to sing, just come right now. Just come and stand here. And the front, come right close. Come right close. And the pastors will help me, and Alistair and Mark and Johnny will help me. Just come right close. Come, just come. Don't look around. Don't look around. Just come. God's going to break out. He's going to break out into your prison. He's going to release you from circumstance. And He's going to lift your eyes upon Him. And it's going to empower your life. So I want you to come right now. Thank you, Niall. Thank you. Jesus. 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 Yes,
you are here.
Yeah. Come right up. Come right up.
You are here.
Don't second guess.
Working in His
presence. Come.
I worship. I worship.
Jesus, make a way.
You are here. Thank you.
There is no one like you, Jesus. No one like you, God. That is who you are. It's who you are.
Yeah.
Holy Spirit, come, come, come again, come again, come again. We open up our hearts to you. We need you. Your church needs you. Power of God. We follow you, Jesus. For the glory of the Father, pour out your Spirit. Come. Just open your heart right now and just ask the Holy Spirit to fill you.
Oh, That is who you are. Yes!